last section talking a little bit about the relation between the cause and the result of dissatisfaction. I mean, that last comment about how then, you know, well, then what are the causes for this whole, like, ongoing cycle rebirth? That's really some pretty heavy, deep psychology, and I'm not going to pretend that I, like, somehow know all that. As far as I can understand, it's kind of like, just sort of get that very deep-seated desire of wanting to be in some way that's going to be enough to keep us going on. And that can be very, you know, the forms of being can range hugely. But I think it's easier to see it from some of the more day-to-day examples of just like desires for things or aversions to things. And when they're looking for a solution, rather than, you know, I dislike that thing, then let me see how I can get rid of that thing, that there's another approach, which is to say, I dislike that thing. Well, if I can change my attitude towards it, that's also another potential solution. Okay. In general, we tend to want to deal with the things rather than wanting to change ourselves, and that in turn reflects a kind of very deep-seated kind of identity. We always feel justified in disliking things or liking things. Okay, but we haven't finished. We've been talking a bit about the first two, and that kind of cause and effect relationship. But we've still got the other two. Well, I mean, you can already see, these two together are what we call, we've used the term before, but we can use it again, samsara, right? Cyclic existence. Cause and effect process. Now, these two, I mean, we can already see this is nirvana, so this is liberation, and this is the path then to liberation. Now, many people will say, again, that nirvana is the effect, and then the path is the cause that brings about nirvana. And I think in many ways it's a very legitimate way of expressing it. If we want to attain this result, and cessation is a very technical word, you want to think of it as liberation or freedom. It sounds a lot nicer for us that. We don't have this, you know, the statue of cessation, the statue of liberty, freedom. And then how do we get to it? So while we can think about that cause and effect, for myself, I want to do a little subtle twist. Rather than thinking of these two as a set of causes that leads to a set of effects, and then this is another bunch of causes which leads to another bunch of effects. Remember, this is cessation. This is the cessation of dissatisfaction. This isn't like, this isn't one effect and this is a different effect. Cessation itself is the absence of dissatisfaction. So when we say effect, it's not really a different thing. It's the effect is the absence of this effect. Which means that this cause then is what? The removal of this cause. Mm-hmm. So this is a cause, this is an effect. This is the removal, the absence of same cause, and this is the absence of same effect. It's not two different cause-effect relationships. This is hit head with hammer, get a sore head. This is don't hit your head with a hammer, don't get a sore head. It's not, oh, you've already hit your head with a hammer, now hit your head with an ice pack. And it's really too late. Right? Now, cessation itself, nirvana, yeah, if we explain it like this, I hope these two will be easier to kind of understand. So, what's cessation? Well, it's none of those things. It's none of the dissatisfaction from not getting what you want. It's none of the dissatisfaction from being associated with things you despise or being separated from the things that you love and so on and so forth. And if you want to take it to the deeper level, freedom from that cycle of rebirth. But then the real big question is, what's the path? What's the method? What's the method to get to that end? But again, this cause, not really good, this is the removal. So the more we can understand, the better we can understand the causes of dissatisfaction and the process from this to this. The process from affliction to dissatisfaction, the easier it is to apply this. And I think this is an important point. Often, if one just has a purely a focus on this without understanding this process, it might not be very effective. I think I mentioned before, my undergraduate degrees in engineering, and I've worked for a very small amount of time in engineering environments. But, you know, when someone has like a machine, when somebody's computer won't work, right? So you go find your computer guru buddy and you want them to fix it. You do IT, don't you? Okay, I'm sure you got lots of people like,
but yeah, my computer won't work.
I mean, what do you first do?
Reboot.
Check those plugged in.
I didn't plug up.
Okay. You try to find out what the problem was, right? Right. Core problems. Is there any power? Control, Alt, Delete, etc., etc. You do diagnostics. You try to find what the problem was. The better you can identify the problem, once you've identified the problem, the solution is far clearer. You don't just like have a list of potential solutions and then you just start at the top of the list. This doesn't make sense, right? Now, the classic way of looking at the path is called the Eightfold Path. Sometimes it's the Eightfold Noble Path. The noble is the same noble as this one. It's kind of a curious term, Eightfold Path. Is it like eight paths? It's not eight paths. That kind of implies that, like, you know, starting point, goal, and there's eight ways to get there. It's like a path that's got eight elements to it. Strictly speaking, it's the eight limbs. The eight limbs of the path, the eight elements. There's a slightly shorter way of looking at that, which is the three trainings.
Yeah. I just want to ask a question before we go into the path about this cessation. So essentially the premise of cessation, achieving nirvana, and doing away with all the dissatisfaction, what if we're not completely so sold on the idea that there is so much dissatisfaction, maybe I enjoy this life rebirth cycle and I want to continue?
Sure. Well then I just say, like I said, I mean, if we look at like dissatisfaction as a thing and then the cause has a cause, it's not as useful as, and like this, nirvana is nirvana, or look at these as individual ones. There is, and a lot of schools used to explain it like this in a more technical way, there is a nirvana for every possible dissatisfaction. So my response to that would be, that's fine, and like, I totally understand that, but if there's anything that you might find dissatisfactory, there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we'll just deal with that.
Mm.
You can still use the same model
to
deal with that. You don't have to buy into the whole thing to get your money's worth out.
Because essentially, would the analogy be appropriate that if you believe in the wheel of samsara and life and rebirth, you want to end that, would that be analogous to someone who doesn't believe in the wheel of rebirth, just committing suicide and ending that?
Analogous in what way?
In the sense that you're ending.
Well, they might think it's analogous. From a Buddhist point of view, it would in fact be very not analogous.
Mm.
Because the basic reason would be the person who then just thinks they can end it all by committing suicide is a very fundamental ignorance, because they simply do not understand this process. And ignorance as one of the afflictive states, if you act, in other words, if you do karma that is underlaid by ignorance, is not going to get you a good result, even though they may think it's a good result.
So is the premise that if you were to, say, balance out some, you know, a total scale of the good and the bad, there would be more bad, there would be more with the birth and the death and all of the bad and the dissatisfaction and the dukkha would be worse than the good that could be discovered.
Like committing suicide?
No, I just mean in the samsara. Why did Buddha want
it's
to...
It's not so much a balance, and some people kind of... I mean, because a lot of Eastern philosophy in the West just gets all that mush together. And we talk about Buddhism in the same breath as talking about a nice... Right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's the balance between the good and the bad. No, Buddhism isn't trying to find some balance between the pain and the good. That's totally different.
I guess my question would be, why did the Buddha in the first place want to escape the wheel, the cycle? Is it to be thought that it's really... I know that there is suffering in the world and there's
yeah.
a lot of terrible things,
yeah.
but also there's some good things. Why do we want to leave that wheel at all in the first place?
Well, I mean, he'd say even the good things are still dissatisfactory.
Because it's impermanent and fleeting.
Yeah, I mean, this kind of comes down to... I don't know if this applies to you. Some people say, well, but you know, what if you were rich and wealthy and powerful? Surely that would be good. But if you go and look at rich and wealthy and powerful people, they don't seem to just suddenly be like very happy, contented people at all.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem to have necessarily resolved their problems. I mean, there's always a gap between like poverty and then just getting out of poverty, but then they do the... Being a bit funky, you know. How much money you've got, and then your like happiness levels, you know. So, it kind of goes like this, very quickly up, and then it very quickly kind of starts going down again. When you're extremely wealthy, you're actually often incredibly dissatisfied, incredibly afraid of protecting their $100 billion. You know, crazy people, you lose $99 billion, and you're still incredibly wealthy. So, I mean, you know, there might be other forms of like. Happiness or good.
Mm-hmm.
You might say, well, what if I'm trying to relieve poverty? Well, yeah, I mean, it's good. You will get out of it. But alleviating people's poverty, then those people will no longer be worried about that. That will no longer be their primary worry. But I guarantee then just some other problem will come up. You know, kind of dissatisfaction is a pretty subjective thing. Everyone's got it, and you just kind of escape some and just become the next one.
Suffering.
So it would be a good thing, but it's still wounded. It doesn't mean like you're never involved. I mean, you could kind of, I think. Part of the underlying Buddhist idea behind that is to remember the Buddha's awakening, and he's got those three insights. So you remember the first one was like seeing his past lives. So I think that's also part of it as well, and also the very description of the Buddha as Gautama, you know, so he's wealthy and lives in luxury and whatever. So he's gone through that. He's had the opportunity to do all these good things still. Couldn't cut it, and then he also can reflect on past lives. Because even in the most exalted, wonderful states in those past lives, still wasn't enough. And even if you can get there, there's no guarantee you can maintain it. Right? Again, it's something to contemplate, but it's not something that you kind of like. And I think when we're dealing with these, back to the idea of looking at these as individual dissatisfactions. It's important to be able to see, okay, so what's the biggest one for me in my life right now? And let me deal with this first. I might be able to deal with this and work to this until it's no longer such a big problem. And there may be another issue, which I've been recently neglecting, now is a bit more in the way. Well, then I turn my attention to this. You know, just start from the big ones first and work our way down. And you'll find, of course, as you go down, they become more subtle. But how it goes, you know. So if we go, smiley faces worth of dollars. That's a nice graph. Okay. So the three trains, which is what we're going to be getting into for the next couple of weeks in more detail. First one is if No, the Eightfold Path and the Three Trainings, it's the same content. It's just breaking it up in different ways. I quite like using these three, it's just simpler. I could easily teach you the Eightfold Path and you'll forget it. Hopefully if I teach you these three, just three items, maybe you can remember them. They start from the external, from the kind of coarse physical behavior. So this deals with our physical actions and our verbal actions. And strictly speaking, this kind of Buddhist ethics is only dealing with that. The next one deals with the inner mental and conceptual states of the mind as they're active within the mind. So, like a sense of anger and being able to calm that anger. But just if we are, say maybe presently right now, we might not necessarily be angry or craving, desirous or ignorant. But just because we don't have that active in my mind right now, doesn't mean I don't have that kind of potential. There still might be circumstances which, you might say, stimulate those. In Buddhist terms, we say we have these like dormant states. You usually almost would, even the calmest, chillest person, a very calm, chill person, I'm sure there's some way that I can annoy the hell out of you and get you angry. Right? So normally it's kind of like dormant. That's pretty good, that you can at least just keep it dormant for a while. But like it's riling up, okay, and then it becomes active. We really want to deal with these problems, we still have to deal with even the dormant states. Now in order to get to those, we need this deep meditative down deep into the mind. See that really deep underlying subconscious traits and tendencies that we have. So this is this kind of process. It's the reverse order of how karma occurs. We have these dormant states within us that are normally just kind of not doing anything. Some circumstances stimulate, agitate us. The dormant, say craving, then becomes active. But it's just mental. Then it becomes stronger, and it becomes things that I say and I do. So back to what I'll say, the coffee example. Maybe I'm like a coffee connoisseur. Maybe I was thinking about something else. I was reading a lovely book about Buddhism the other day. I'm in a very calm and clear state. But then, I lock on. And when I see the coffee, what happens? My latent coffee cravings become active, and then I act. Now then the practice is like the reverse order. In theory, if you can just deal with the very deep latent craving and aversion and ignorance, that would be enough. But it's not that simple. Simple example is like, let's say somebody's an alcoholic and they want to stop drinking alcohol. I mean, the basic thing is to just get rid of your craving for alcohol, right? Simple as that. Just go off. You don't want to be alcoholic? Don't desire alcohol. Simple. Okay, so you think, well, that's all I need to do. I'm not going to change anything else about my lifestyle. I'm still going to go out with my buddies to the bar every night. So you go out with your buddies to the bar and you tell your mother, oh, I'm sober now, I don't drink at all. Anybody's like, well, let us drink for you, we'll celebrate you with a round, and that drink. I mean, if you're in that environment, is it going to be easy to maintain that no desire for alcohol? It's going to be pretty hard, right? The whole external environment around us is one of the factors that it stimulates those latent tendencies and makes them active. So the ethical thing isn't just our own external behavior and things we say and we do. I mean, that affects our environment. And so this is also not just our own behavior, it's also the whole environment that we're living in. If we're in an environment which simply doesn't stimulate or bring up those afflictions, at least lets us, in general, keep a calm state of mind. course, that in itself might not be enough, right? It's like you can easily live in a temple for like a month or two. Oh, everything's lovely and calm here. Oh, it's so calm. But if you've just used the calm of the temple to get that calm without really working on yourself, as soon as you leave and go outside, what's going to happen? Right, I'm going to come up then. Oh, I've just been in the temple for a month. And if you cut me off at an intersection again, I'm going to beep, 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 beep. Right, okay. That's you just go and live there, but you don't really do anything. Developing calm in itself, just meditative calm, is already, you know, again, there's many levels and layers, many different descriptions of Buddhist meditation, the first meditation, the second, the third, the fourth, many different layers. Again, we can see how this was traditionally a model for monastic practitioners, because it was largely accepted that if you really want to get into this, you pretty much have to set aside all the regular busyness of life. So that's why the monastics, they didn't have jobs, they just had their robes and a bowl. In the morning, you go out, beg for food, get your food, go back, eat your food, and meditate. You don't have any other distractions. I mean, our contemporary system, you might go on a retreat, you might go on a 7-day or a 10-day or even a longer retreat. Hopefully, many of the places will be a silent retreat. The only person you talk to is a meditation instructor. All right, you don't have your phone, you're not reading newspapers. So at least temporarily, all these external stimuli are not agitating them. And under that situation, it's easier to really calm down the mind, get very deep down, where we can start to see very deep subconscious traits and tendencies that we have, and by seeing them clearly, start to work on them and change them. You come out of the retreat, you know, you might make a couple of steps forward in your progress, you come out of the retreat, you go a few steps back, but if you do this long enough, slowly you will progress. Right? So it's not to say that after the retreat you just lose it all. Continual practice does have an effect. And this has now been well studied in, say, psychology. They've found what we might call, say, expert meditators. And expert meditators, regular, non-meditative, you know, state of mind. So in other words, an expert meditator, when they're just doing their day-to-day stuff, the calm and clarity of their mind is often better than a beginner when they're actually meditating. That kind of builds up, that practice builds up, and it just becomes from a short-term practice into just not like hardwired, but it just, that's just how they are in general. From that, then we can start to unpack the roots. And again, think of these, you know, you're unpacking these causes and these dissatisfactions one by one. There might be certain points when we can unplug a big problem that was causing numerous problems. It's not a simple linear process. Right? That's fairly general terms. If we want to talk about the Eightfold Path, each of them begins with the term right, which refers to the fact that these things are done with a correct understanding. And we can say that correct understanding is basically understanding this process of cause and effect. The first one is right view, which is basically like kind of this theoretical model. If we understand that this is where we have these problems, this is how they're caused, and this is what we need to do to eliminate them. Right view. And that is the first one. If we can undertake these practices with this understanding, they'll be far more effective. So, right intention. Whereas right view is kind of an intellectual, correct understanding, right intention is more of an emotional one. It's the elimination of active states of craving and aversion and ill will. And maintaining a mental state that is free from those. You could say the reverse. Kindness, generosity, compassion. From the mental, intellectual and emotional, we go then to the things that we say. Again, we can see from the inside mental state then to the external manifestation. Right speech. So if we have a right view and we have a right intention, the things that we say are not going to be in general harmful and violent or causing confusion for others. This is our speech karma. Right action. This is our physical karma. Again, these ones here are in our ethical behavior category. Yep. And we've got one more in that category, which is a bit broader, right? Livelihood. Now, I mean, in a sense, our livelihood, the job that we do, is kind of comprised of things that we say and things that we do. But it is given its own separate category. And, I mean, there's a monastic definition of that, but in terms of lay ones, it just means, basically, you're not being a butcher, you're not being an arms dealer, these kinds of, I'd say, reprehensible professions. Some people maybe don't think they're reprehensible. But, you know, why is this set out as a separate category? Well, how many hours a day do you spend doing your job? 8 hours a day. Well, I mean, I have other time. 24. So, you know, if you're going to be doing a job 6 hours a day, you're going to have 8 or longer. That's a lot of our waking life, right? Now, I often give the example of my mother. My mother used to be a primary school teacher, an elementary school teacher. And once you've been an elementary school teacher, teaching 5-year-olds and 6-year-olds for 40 years, it kind of shapes your personality. When you meet my mum, it's like, is she a school teacher? Yes, she is. Right? Mm-hmm. And we kind of know that, like, different professions kind of shape people's personalities. I mean, people probably have that kind of personality when they start, but then by doing that, it kind of shapes them. And that's pretty important because certain professions shape intentions. If you are a butcher, I mean, you're looking at animals in terms of how to kill them, how to chop them up. I mean, even when I was much younger, I used to do martial arts, I used to do a lot of taekwondo. And I even know doing it then, you walk down the street, I grew up in a pretty tough town, so maybe this was a self-defense mechanism. You walk down the street and you're thinking like, oh, you know, if this person attacked me, I would kick them where? Where's the best target to hit someone? And it's like, pretty violent kind of, you know, tension. Nothing, I don't know who that person is. But it's shaping my mind. And to give another example, I mean, this wasn't even my job, just something that I did. When I was 22, I was in a situation in a bar fight, which had nothing to do with me. One of my friends was attacked by a very drunk person. But due to that training, I responded in a way that just take up a fighting stance. It's like something's going down, then you just drop into that. You don't think about it. And because of that, the bouncer thought I'd started the fight, took me outside, threw me down some steps, cracked open my head, you can see the scars, the 38 stitches in my head and fractured my neck. And part of that was due to responding in that way. And that's just conditioning from something that I did a couple of nights a week for a few years as a teenager. So profession shapes us. It shapes our intentions. Compare a butcher to a doctor or a nurse. Right? Your attitude towards the heat of the body. These three then are our ethical content because they're dealing with the external baby. We then go into what's called right effort. It's kind of a general term. definitions to it. Technical definition is unwholesome things that we do, trying to stop them, but also trying not to do unwholesome things that we presently don't do. So you might say, oh, well, I'm going to quit alcohol, so I took up smoking instead. Okay, doesn't seem to make much sense, right? So quit drinking, but then also don't start up smoking as a substitute. Wholesome things that we already do, keep on doing them. And wholesome things that we don't yet do, we can try to start doing them. In other words, it's just a kind of encouragement, as I keep working on, keep working on. The last two deal with our meditative state. Right, mindfulness, a very popular term these days. There's a very big kind of secular mindfulness movement going on. And I'll say, the way in which the word mindfulness is used in many of these contemporary mindfulness movements is not at all the classical way. It's kind of, it's had its definition made so wide and broad that it's a little bit meaningless. Here it kind of means the preliminary stages of the last one. Right, concentration or right meditation. It's like the preliminary stages of concentration.
What were the Sanskrit word for mindfulness and concentration?
The Sanskrit term is smriti, the Pali word is sati,
yeah.
In Chinese it is nian. Yeah. Originally this term is actually related to remembering something, to remember it. And it kind of means like if you're gonna focus on something for your meditation topic, so maybe you're gonna use your breath as your meditation object, you need to remember that and not forget. In other words, don't let your mind wander off to something else. So you're establishing your focus on that object. As that focus develops and deepens, then we can talk about concentration or meditation.
So it's like a just trying to reflect to my meditation experience that you know you are engaging in the practice, basically sitting down and started to supposedly meditate, supposedly, and then you drift off and suddenly okay back.
Yeah. So when you're returning it back, then you're establishing your mindfulness.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's kind of had its definition expanded to be this. A long story related to some early modern movements in Theravada and Buddhist traditions and the shift of emphasis between calm and insight, and it's kind of been pushed into having this kind of sense. So we often see the idea of mindfulness and insight meditation. So it's now taken on this kind of sense of what we might call wisdom or insight rather than the starting point of concentration. When this deepens and we can start to see where the problems are and deal with them again, so this is kind of our meditative side, then we can go back, we kind of can go back to view and intention. When the mind is calm and clear, it's very easy to see the mental processes that go on. I remember one time, I think it was about this second or third 7-day retreat that I did, and the end of the retreat, so the teacher, Venerable Crozier, he got everyone, this was at the seminary, so he had everyone like come up and say a few comments about the retreat. And I remember just when he asked that, and it felt like, because I managed to keep a fair bit of calm, actually my mind very focused for quite a while. And then I'm like, it felt like wheels turning in my head, like in my mind, that it'd be very calm. And the process of how you go from a calm state and how a thought begins to form and associates with other forms was kind of like slowed down like 100 times. And seeing that process of thoughts and emotions moving in my head was like, and I felt, rather than like it's me thinking it, I felt like a spectator to that and I can see this whole process going on. So when we can have that kind of concentration and calm, it aids us back here by understanding these processes. And due to that clarity as well, we can also see like at what point we start to fall into negative states of mind, or we start to respond to pleasure with craving and pain with aversion and so on and so forth. And that clarity also comes from what they call mental flexibility. Most people, when we start meditating, the mind's kind of clunky. It's like you say, well, I want to fix it on this thing, but the mind won't listen. The mind's doing its own thing. You're like, focus here, and it won't do it. It's not pliable. It's not workable. It's kind of stuck in this shape, and I want it to be in this shape. But that constant process makes the mind very flexible. And when you have that kind of calm, you can then direct the mind to certain things with a huge amount of power and focus. Again, for another analogy, a bit like, you know, if you've got the usual rays of the sun shining on a piece of paper, it's not going to burn the paper. It's not strong enough, right? But if you take a magnifying glass, did you do this as a kid? That magnifying glass, adjust the length, burn holes and dry leaves and pieces of paper. Maybe it's just me and my car around here. Okay. You can focus that light. It's the same light, but by focusing on it, it gives it incredible power. So it's a similar thing. By focusing the mind on one thing, it gives it this really sharp clarity and focus to examine things. And you also have the flexibility to do it. Feeds back in here. We can further clarify our understanding and our emotional state. By further clarifying these, our actions, easier to maintain in positive, healthy states, which affects our whole day-to-day mental environment, and also our external environment, which helps us, makes it easier for us to develop mindfulness and further strengthen meditation. Positive feedback. So you don't kind of fulfill one, perfect one, and then perfect two and perfect three. You're kind of working on them all at the same time. They all feed back and influence into each other. As you go through seeing these processes of afflictions causing problems and eliminating them, but really eliminating the very deep seeds of them, the very deep latent tendencies. The further you go in, the more subtle it becomes, but ultimately the more effective and powerful. Understand that process of the path without understanding the problems, right? You want to reach health, you need to understand illness and its symptoms and so forth. And like any kind of medicine, a holistic approach is going to be far more effective than a simply allopathic treat symptoms. This stuff, seriously, I've been doing this for quite a while, and this is still, the layers and levels are many. Any thoughts, questions?
What's the difference between awareness and mindfulness?
Oh, okay. So in the present popular form, mindfulness is almost described as being awareness. Mindfulness is often they use the term bare awareness, where you are just simply aware of what is occurring without being judgmental about it. Particularly with the idea of sometimes labeling it. So if you have a sad feeling, you just say sad feeling. You give it a label, you're aware of it, but you're not judging, you're not saying I shouldn't feel sad or it's good enough, whatever. Though some traditions will say you don't label it, you just see it, but you don't you don't judge it. So by not judging means you don't push it away or you don't pull it towards, but you see it clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we think about that in terms of our basic things here, not going towards, no desire, not pushing away, no aversion, seeing it clearly, no ignorance. So yeah, that will have a very powerful effect. But originally that's kind of not necessarily, I don't think, the key definition of mindfulness. The mindfulness was, so in order to be able to do that, to just be aware of something without getting caught up in it, it's not easy. Normally we get pulled into things. You know, I can just say, like, just sit here right now and just be aware of things and have no aversion or no desire for them. It's really not that easy. So often what we need is, we first need to kind of calm down the mind a bit. So we might use a technique, say, be mindful of the body, or be mindful of our breath. Or we might have another technique, maybe a visualization or something. Settling the mind on that for a while, gets the mind nice and calm. And then when the mind's calm, then we can do this practice of just being aware of states without the judgmental attitude towards them. Now, that process of just settling the mind on that object to calm it, to me, is more like the older version of mindfulness.
Mm-hmm.
Staying on your object of focus without letting it run away.
Sorry, I'm a bit confused by that answer, because it sounds like you're saying that mindfulness in today, I was saying it, is that awareness that you can't get without calming, that is the mindfulness.
Yeah, so in the modern sense, they kind of describe the mindfulness as just like the awareness, but I think early on, mindfulness would be like your first practice of just focusing on that object. Then when you kind of then step back and just be non-judgmental, that it's not mindfulness, that's what we call insight.
Okay, and you get that through the mindfulness.
Yeah, you get through the mindfulness, focus, you can take it further and really concentrate on something until the mind is very calm. And then what you can kind of do is, you can then just kind of drop that object. I use the focus on one object to stop my mind following after me another object, like it normally does, right? Once I've dropped all these other objects, then I no longer need to use this. This is just a tool to stop my mind running around. So then I stop focusing on that. Then what's going to happen is, there's still going to be things that occur. And I can just see them clearly for what they are. No attraction, no aversion, clarity. Then you're dealing with insight. But that might be difficult to maintain. You might be focusing, nice and calm. And then I step back and I do this inside. You do that long enough, your mind's going to start to chase things after a while. Okay, I'm chasing again. Okay, bring back my focus. Focus. Calm down again. Stop and look. And then I start to chase after things again. So this kind of balance between the calm and the insight is quite a bit of work. Mm-hmm. So the modern usage is more like insight, but earlier on mindfulness is more like a precursor to calm. Just getting myself to even focus on this in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, is that clear?
Yeah. It sounds like you don't really like the manner approach to mindfulness. I don't know.
It's not that I don't like it.
It's just
it's confusing for people because they're using a term in a very different way.
Mm-hmm.
So then people have that understanding that mindfulness just means awareness. And then if you use that and go look at the Eightfold Path, it's confusing because why would you have this non-judgmental awareness before concentration? In terms of how you practice it, it's very difficult to do it like that.
Okay.
So it's just like kind of, there were other terms for what they're talking about. It's called insight, it's called prajna, it's called vipassana. Stick to that term, but it's just a term that's become very catchy and popular and so forth.
I think that's why they took it.
Yeah, so it sounds.
I feel now at the moment that it was a way
from random context mentioned the word mindfulness, I have absolutely no idea what they actually mean, if they could mean
yeah.
it to be anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's a kind of a password.
Yeah. So is insight the state where you can view, it's the state where you can then maybe have a one time, because I know there's also like individual insights
mm-hmm.
that
sure.
can occur. So is this word referring to the state where that may occur or the occurrence of those things?
Well, it can be both. It can, first of all, be that clarity of seeing things and those processes. But because in that state, you've already, first of all, temporarily freed yourself from the emotional or cognitive problems. And what often happens is, I mean, this is kind of the way I'd explain it. Normally, those subconscious, like, emotions and self-centered views and whatever are influencing all those things, and they're creating tensions in the mind and a lack of clear understanding, right? When they kind of dissolve, it reshapes things. Like your mind reshapes itself. It's like defragging your brain or something. And it really feels like something. And that can be a feeling that one can get, sort of like, oh. And things become clearer. Now it's quite an abstract idea, but I think the actual experience of it is also quite abstract as well. It's like, oh, it's clearer. I understand better. And you say, like, understand what? It's kind of not, it's not really something that you can, like, explain, like, oh, I understand that E equals MC squared. No, not like that. But it's just like the shift into a clearer state of mind. And it's also a freer state because those afflictions are like kind of breaking down. So they can be smaller or bigger. Sometimes they can just be very small ones. Sometimes they can be quite like, really like paradigm shifting. Sometimes it happens to people on retreats that we had last week. That sort of thing. I did a long retreat and then they came out like, well, okay, worldview changed, things are different, I gotta rethink this or re-try to understand this. It can be quite profound like that, yeah. It's like bigger and smaller. So it can refer to the situation where that can occur and its occurrence. Here we're just using one term, but in the traditional vocabulary there's
I was just trying to say a joke that with a Buddhist philosophy, there's a list and there's a list within the list and there's a list within the list and there's a list within the list.
There's four truths and dissatisfaction has eight, and then you can break, or you can use a system of three, and then blah blah blah, the path, you can use a system of eight or three, and yeah, lots of. I mean, a lot of this stuff is pretty early Buddhism. It gets developed a bit after the Buddha, highly systematized. They're nice frameworks, and I think it's very useful to kind of, I could say, memorize the framework or know the framework. Don't get too caught on the framework, though. You know, it's not quite such a simple, there are eight things. There are not seven or seven and a half or nine. There are only eight. That's a bit too cookie cutter. But it gives us a kind of framework to look at the various different aspects of it, right, and the processes of it. So they're useful tools.
I'm just a little unclear on the kind of concept of nirvana. What do we mean when we say nirvana?
Well, we're talking about no dissatisfaction. Of course, it means none of the cause. So. We're not acting in a way where we're just simply chasing after sensual experiences, but also in terms of what I call ignorance versus wisdom, a kind of a clarity to things. And I remember once many years ago talking to this Christian guy, and he kind of thought like, oh, when the Buddha attained nirvana, then he just kind of like puff of smoke, like beam me up.
Scotty,
but No. I mean, he's still very much like, he's still got his five aggregates. He's still very much a person. But, you know, all that whole process isn't being driven by a self-centered view, or driven by just these craving and aversion. And so what then happens is, you know, it's like if we get angry and we look at a situation, we don't see it clearly. We're clouded by that emotion, right? Or desire. You've got a thing for something, people tell you, oh, but you know, it's not that great. You're like, no, it's the best thing, don't say otherwise. We don't then see things clearly when we're clouded by those. So it's not only that that one state of mind still totally functions, it functions even better. And then the potential for like positive emotions, kindness, concern, generosity, can be unrestricted because we can be generous without, you know, self-serving generosity or I'll give you this much, but I'm going to try to keep some for myself. No, we're not driven by those things at all. So it's a kind of a, I mean, maybe potential movement, like optimum state of human potential, if you like.
And from what I've heard, the nirvana is also the release from the wheel of incarnation.
Sure, because those, you know, those same things that cloud the mind are also the same things that, that constant seeking for becoming. Now there is, and we're going to do this in our last class, the Bodhisattva path, which kind of like peak performance bodhisattva, not Buddha, but bodhisattva, is basically an equivalent state in terms of the clarity and those positive emotional states. But then it's a deliberate choice not to end the cycle of rebirth. And there's different explanations how that happens. But basically, I'm going to continue to take rebirth and come back to this world in order to help others. I still see that cyclic existence is dissatisfactory, but I see that others need help, so I'm still willing to do it because they need someone to help them. Because if someone doesn't help them, these people are just like, you know, such a mess. So I'll do that on their behalf. And you can see, I think, from that why that ideal is a very popular ideal. It's highly altruistic.
The altruism has some desire behind it, no? Doesn't that kind of, you will be dissatisfied by not having saved everyone.
But remember when we talked about desire, it's not just a wanting to do something. It was very specifically like sensual desire, and a desire like to be in some way.
Okay.
Yeah, but you could argue with
bodhisattva.
Sure, surely isn't the idea that you want to be someone who helps other people, isn't that like another? Yeah, it is. And you'd say that, and that wanting to be a bodhisattva to help other people is the very thing that enables the bodhisattva to keep coming back. But it's not for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that seen as a personal, like, is that seen as the higher value than just
liberation for oneself?
Yeah.
In Mahayana Buddhism, yeah, very much so. And I think sometimes Mahayana Buddhism can be a bit over the top and not just saying sort of like it's a higher ideal, but you're just seeking liberation for yourself. You selfish. Selfish. What are you? How could you do such a thing? And sometimes I think it's kind of a bit overdone. Like, I'm sure if somebody wants to be happy, like, why should you make them feel guilty about that? And other traditions, though, say Theravada traditions, do tend to think that yes, it is a higher ideal, but they won't discourage people from seeking their own freedom.
Is it kind of the thing where by the time you get to that point, you're probably going to be the type to want to contemplate?
Not necessarily. In fact, because the kind of altruism and that desire to help others, at first, is still based around a sense of self. And so, you know, that's what I say, like, a sense of self is something that we ultimately need to get rid of. But ultimately. In the meantime, it can be a positive thing. I mean, normally people act from a selfish point of view, not just from a sense of self, but selfishly. You can also act from a sense of self altruistically. I'm going to be the good guy. I'm going to be the hero. I'm going to be the one that helps people. I mean, that's still a self view, but it's for the benefit of others. That, I would say, is at least a better step. And then, once you've got that as your basic mode of life, then you can remove your sense of self and free yourself. But if you don't do that in the start, and you just go from, I'm just going to remove my sense of self and free myself, by the time you get to that point, it's going to be very difficult to suddenly say, oh, and now I'm going to become altruistic. Who's going to become altruistic?
Mm.
Very little motivation for it. So, and those kinds of teachings that talk about, and yeah, they are basically kind of two different paths. At first, they kind of are on the same track, but you do get to a point whereby they split. Even when they split, there's a point where you can maybe go back, but then in turn, they'll both get to a point whereby if you choose this option, you get to a point of no return. Creepy. Yeah. So that's got a whole other connotation. Tweedledee and Tweedledum. Okay, so you get to a point whereby, you know, you've removed that like sense of self and those core afflictions. I'm free, but it doesn't necessarily mean I have the ability to help others.
Mm-hmm.
But some people don't choose that option. But if you want to be able to help others, you kind of need to start working on that fairly early as well. Yeah, otherwise if you get to that end point, it's difficult to develop afterwards. But maybe it's a bit like I don't know if it's a good analogy, like getting a PhD. Some people with PhDs make good teachers. Some don't. They both have PhD level understanding of their topics and subjects. That's not the question. But some during that process take teaching roles and become TAs and they develop those skills. They plan to do that in the process and so then they have that ability later on. Some don't. After a PhD, I guess you could learn how to do it, but it would be harder. Not a good analogy.
But a PhD would be motivated to learn because they have to teach, whereas...
They don't. This is always the thing that, and that can, particularly people when they first graduate, a lot of people are like, you know, when your PhD says, dissertation, you've got to write that, you've got to do your good research, push, that's all you get, you know, when they give you your degree, it's basically on your dissertation, your research. And then you apply for your first job, and then the first thing they do is, like, you have to teach this and that, and a lot of people are like, I have no idea. I taught one-hour class one time, because my professor wanted me to, and I had no other experience, and it's a critical shock. Some people not. Some people might have a bunch of teaching experience, and by the time they get their first job, like, okay. So kind of like what you got to do to pass, and then your expectations after this very, very different things. It's silly. To say the least.
I suppose whether PhD sounds reasonable.
My description, you mean? Of it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
I mean.
We're saying the same thing. Okay. Our time is a little bit past. Hopefully, this has given you enough to think about, not just over lunch, but for the next 166 hours before next class. Next week we're going to be getting into ethical behaviour, and then after that we've got two classes on meditation. I'm trying